The trouble with having a whole day before you start is that you have to deal with yourself for the day, which is ordinarily bad, but extraordinarily bad now. So I've written a new beginning to what we're going to do. I have overwritten this lecture, so I'm going to, depending on how my nerves are, I'll be reading parts and then working outside of that as I begin to feel a little more confident. Thank you everybody for giving of your time. I don't take that for granted and I do appreciate it. Today was a lovely day for me. I'm sure it was for you too. For those who were at the sessions this morning of our research days and had the opportunity to listen to the panel with Hirabina, Muhammad and Kathleen, I just felt dead proud to be a part of this university, and I felt that previously, and here I'm not being gratuitous, I mean this very sincerely. At IRE, because I was a discussant at a couple of our colleagues' presentations, I got to hear people talking about their work from the school, and I was unfamiliar with their work, and it was just so very, very impressive. So I feel very, very fortunate to be here. And if I see anyone from Norway, I will tell them that. I'm glad that you're all hydrated. It will help. Okay, so when I talk about inclusive education, I predictably start with the question that I ask that really is the foundation for the scholarship that comes after it and the activism. And that is, what kind of world do we want to live in? It's a simple question, but boy, very, very, very difficult to come to terms with. And then the subsidiary question, well, what does education look like in that world? But there's a question that is before that, and that is, what type of education do we need to get to that world? So those are the questions that really provide the foundation for what I'm going to be talking about this evening. And I think that this juncture in our history, more than at many other times, we need to be asking those questions. We need to be thinking about exclusion and how that happens, and inclusion. And that's what I want this evening to be about. So I'm going to start off just by giving you a sense. My remarks will be very much concentrating on issues around exclusion and inclusion of people with disabilities. But I do take inclusion as referring to potentially all learners, and particularly those who are vulnerable in the context that they're in.
The mother of a man who named this claim was hounded to death by yobs has paid tribute to her son, saying he was a true gentleman. It's emerged the authorities were warned David Askew was being targeted years before he was found dead at his home in Hattersley in Greater Manchester. This video footage shows the 64-year-old who had learning difficulties being taunted by local youths, although there's no suggestion those pictured here were involved in the incident which led up to his death. It was on Wednesday night that Mr. Askew confronted a gang of teenagers. When they ran off, he collapsed. His thought stress could have been a factor. Police now say an 18-year-old man has been arrested on suspicion of his manslaughter. Officers in Greater Manchester say they've done everything they could to protect Mr. Askew, but some neighbours are unconvinced.
We didn't see it. I didn't see it. His life was frustrating. His death was caused through bullets to death. He was baited, constantly baited.
Sorry, Sue.
No, that's
fine. Just the backstory to that is that the gentleman who was taunted and died, he'd been teased as a child by the parents of the children who were now teasing him. And it seems to me that tells us. That tells us precisely why we need to be thinking about inclusive education. Now we'll go to the start that I planned. I do have a plan. I kind of got carried away with myself and got a bit grandiose because I took a musical title. I thought this would be a lecture in three movements, but that really is a conceit. There are three bits. The first bit is talking about the gravitational pull of conservatism, and I hope I make clear what I mean there. Then the second part, or the second bit, will be talking about exclusion, and just the way in which I try to make sense of that and build a theory of it. And then the last part, and it's the most tentative part of all, because it's the work that I'm thinking about right now, is looking at issues of perspective. So that's the plan. Between plans and their execution falls the shadow. So Frank Zappa left this world too soon. He died at the age of 52. His musical legacy, comprising some of the most complicated polyrhythms and atonal soundscapes, is absolutely immense. But he left us much more. Some of his retorts in interviews and his writing are now iconic and often referenced in work on almost any subject. I want to join that tradition as a way of commencing this inaugural lecture. In his autobiography, which he called The Real Frank Zappa Book, he opens one section with the heading Jazz, the Music of Unemployment. His relationship with jazz was enigmatic, as musicologist Jeff Wilkes demonstrates with forensic zeal. While Zappa declared his disdain for jazz, in the various incarnations of his bands and orchestras, most notably the Mothers of Invention, he surrounded himself with musicians with stellar jazz pedigrees. A quick and incomplete roll call includes Bruce, Tom and Walt Fowler, Ruth and Ian Underwood, Gary Barone, Jean LaPonty, George Duke, John Guerin, Alan Zabel, people who know the Australian pianist, Vinnie Carietta, Chester Thompson, Chad Wakeman and Jane Migliori. Moreover, his music embraced many genres within the jazz family. Listen to the album Roxy and Elsewhere, and you'll hear Zappa tell the audience that jazz is not dead. It just smells funny. Devotees of jazz and Zappa, the quote is amusing and perplexing. Now my take on that involves two explanations. The first is that he was typically prodding the line of respectability with the broomstick of irreverence. I actually liked that sentence. I'll read it again. It was the first is that he was typically prodding the line of respectability with the broomstick of irreverence. It's just a humorous provocation that he really hadn't thought about too much. My second explanation, or attempt to understand it, is that he's saying that all artistic genres go through a similar cycle. They confront what has gone before, offering up something that is apparently radical, innovative, new, and then they become respectable. I remember watching an interview on Canadian television with jazz saxophonist Branford Marsalis. Of whom there was a picture earlier today. And Marsalis reminded us that he committed Bach's 186 rules of harmony to memory before breaking them. Whose rules, he asked, did Bach break when he established the canon? Today's radical utterances, like yesterday's, morph into tomorrow's conservatism. In Reflections on Exile, Edward Said presents an elegant essay entitled Travelling Theory Reconsidered. And just for those of you who've not seen me present before, I always put a copy of the book cover and then a photo of the author there, just to suggest that these are very real people who are producing this work, and therefore it's offered perhaps as provocation and it's contestable. In the essay, he reflects that by the time George Lukács' theory of ratification was adopted by Lucian Goldman in Paris and Raymond Williams in Cambridge, it had lost some of its original power and rebelliousness. Theories born from and organically linked to historical circumstances are degraded, his words, degraded and subdued by the passage of time and changing circumstances. They become a relatively tame academic substitute for the real thing, whose purpose was political change. Previously, I've registered my view that theories of inclusive education are nearing exhaustion from their intensive travels. Inclusive education, to paraphrase Said, has been tamed and domesticated. And here I have to insert a kind of a stipulation, and that is that when I'm talking about inclusive education in this sense, I'm not talking about so much the education for all agenda that you would have seen from Jontian in 1990. I'm talking more about inclusive education as it refers to issues pertaining to the education of students with disabilities. It has lost its insurrectionary zeal. I say theories because there is no general theory of inclusive education. It's an assembly hall within which gather disparate and desperate postulations and propositions about human and social pathology and their relationship with education. Almost a decade ago, Julie Allen, a Scottish academic, and me described inclusive education as a troubled and troubling field of education research, housing highly charged, often emotive, and personalised contests. Nothing seems to have changed. The global spread of inclusive education, thanks in large measure to the combined reach of the World Wide Web and organisations like UNESCO, OECD, World Bank, a range of NGOs, development agencies, publishing agglomerations, is near complete. Some researchers have tracked... Some researchers have tracked this progress of inclusive education by starting back at Jontian in Thailand, the Conference of Education, or World Forum of Education Conference, and then they talk next about Salamanca 4 years later, 1994, in Spain, with its particular emphasis on the education of students with disabilities. And on the slide, I have a picture in one corner of Mel Ainsco with his hand outstretched. Mel talks about the importance of the Salamanca statement and framework for action, as does Alan Dyson on the other side of Mel, in terms of its impact on English education policy, which Alan in particular remarked was an extraordinary thing because England tended not to defer to others. Also in that frame I've put Tony Booth, because he and Mel produced the Inclusive Education Index, which has been translated into many, many different languages and has become quite influential in with education jurisdictions around the world. Salamanca was interesting. If you look at the statement coming out of it, those with special educational needs, it says, must have access to regular schools which will accommodate them within a child-centred pedagogy capable of meeting these needs. It also says regular schools with this inclusive orientation are the most effective means of combating discriminatory attitudes, creating welcoming communities, building an inclusive society, and achieving education for all. Moreover, they provide an effective education to the majority of children and improve the efficiency and ultimately the cost-effectiveness of the entire system. But then Alan Dyson and Brian Norwich from Exeter went on to say that part of the problem with, and this is getting to the nub of what I want to say about inclusive education as a travelling theory, is that part of the problem is that Salamanca dealt in absolutes and it didn't talk about an inclusive education, it simply mentions the regular school. So that therein lies a fundamental problem for, or I think a fundamental problem for inclusive education, and that is its lack of definition, and because within the framework of Salamanca and so on, there is special reference to special educational needs, it's become that assembly hall for all comers. And what you will see is people nodding in agreement with each other, but talking about all kinds of different things. Others might take a longer view of history. And I've just selected Scott Danforth from Chapman, I think he is now. He was at San Diego. Scott wrote a splendid book called The Incomplete Child, and he takes us back to Oak Forest, Illinois, Institution for Delinquent Children in 1929, and to the doorway of the bathroom where on a cold tiled bathroom floor, when the other children had gone to bed, Samuel A. Kirk taught one of the children, a mental defective, how to read. And here's Scott. The two sat on the cold tile floor under a small light in the corridor, whispering so as not to be caught by the staff nurses. There, in the least auspicious surroundings possible, the young man, who would later be viewed as the father of the field of learning disabilities, first encountered a child who could not read. I then go on and say, you know, alternatively, people might like to go further back, they might go into the latter part of the 1700s and visit Jean-Marc Gaspar Etal and his legendary work with Victor, which had some sort of Mary Shelley overtones, doesn't it? The Wild Boy of Avignon, and many in special education, or presenting special education histories will look at this as one of the watermarks or the high watermarks in the development of the field. He then set up a school for deaf mutes in France, there's Guggenbourg and so on. But the histories that I really like are histories like John Lewis's that take a more critical turn. His history of special education in the Victorian Education Department here in Australia is particularly interesting in the way that it looks at a whole range of political influences that are going on at the time. If I was pushed to think about the history further, I would take us to a different set of scholars. And people might recognise some of these people. Down in the bottom, it's my left-hand corner, is Mike Oliver. Mike Oliver, who in 1990 gave us the politics of disablement and is seen as one of the prime movers with people like Dick Finkelstein as the development of the social model of disability. It was very, very sad. Julie Allen and I spent a day with Mike researching for our book, doing inclusive educational research. And it was one of the saddest interviews I think I've done. I came away on the train feeling really, really depressed, in the sense that Mike was saying he felt that he contributed nothing other than to his own career. And those who've been active in the disabled people's movement, that is the most unexpected reaction. I've also got photos of Len Barton above Mike with the hat on, and who was the founding editor of Disability, Handicap and Society, now Disability and Society. Across from Len is Sally Tomlinson, who is the author of A Sociology of Special Education, which came out in 1982. I put these people in because they start to give an alternative view of the development of special education. And I want to say something about that. I'm not demonising special education. I'm not presenting special education as problematic in and of itself. There were times, or at the time of the development of special education, you can see it as that radical force, if you like. It was an attempt, a successful attempt, to make sure that people with disabilities who were not, children with disabilities who were not receiving an education, had access to participate in an education. And therein is a radical movement. And that is to be applauded. The history is incomplete in that surrounding that is a history of eugenics and a history whereby it was not just a case of the development of special education, but the problem of regular education that has policed its borders very, very well over the years. So that there has developed what I would refer to as a codependent relationship between special and regular education. Each serves the other. And therein, I think, has been the force or the gravity of conservatism. And I just included Tom Screen in the bottom of the slide, holding up a mask of himself 40 years earlier. And I do that because the first international conference I went to was in Cardiff, the International Congress on Special Education. And it was an amazing conference. Tom Screedy got up and he started off an address by saying, there are two major threats to democracy in education. First, special education, because it allows for children to be educated away from their neighbour, away from their siblings, and for the world not to know, not to learn about disability in the way that it should. And the second threat to educational democracy, he argued, was educational administration, because it gave the rationale to allow that to happen. So I was really taken by that, and that's why I put it in there. If I was writing my history, I'd then jump, so I'm doing now, and I think I really have lost my place. I jumped to the integration report in Victoria in 1984. And for those of you who are worrying, I did return that to tomorrow. It's okay. It was an interesting report in that it was written by a sociologist. The principal writer was Julian Fulcher, a sociologist from Monash University. So it had a very, very different hue to the to previous reports, such as the Warnock. It came out as a very radical instantiation of the rights of people with disabilities. So there were five guiding principles. Let me just read a couple of them to you. All children have a right to be enrolled in their neighbourhood school. All children have a right to be enrolled in their neighbourhood school. Notice that there isn't much equivocation about that. It isn't the language that I call the language of conditionality that we're used to. There'll be non-categorisation of children. Resources and services should be school-based, and there she's referring to the local school. There'll be collaborative decision-making practices, and all children can learn and be taught. So I said I read some of them to you, I read the five. She was referring, when she was talking about in the report, and the report came unstuck, really. She was referring to students with disabilities or impairments, disabilities and problems in schooling. So what happened then with the pool of funding that was available for what ostensibly people had imagined would be a movement of systems of education, a movement of children from special schools to regular schools, and with their resources and professional knowledge and support and so on, it didn't happen that way. What happened was that schools thought carefully about this bit, problems in schooling. That's Peter, it's Kathy. And what happened was, rather than you seeing a contraction of the special sector, we actually saw an expansion, a slight expansion in that time, accompanied by a ballooning of the identification of kids already in school. And the problem is that whilst it was a very well written policy, there was too much room for interpretation, as Michael Looney suggests to us in what I think is the best academic model of policy making that I've seen. So, what I'm doing is I'm saying, if you want to understand something, and I'm not saying this at all, this is Foucault, this is Nicholas Rose, when he's, Nicholas Rose in The Politics of Everyday Life, tells that the lesson from Foucault's Birth of the Clinic is that if you want to understand the development of medical knowledge, you better look in a whole range of other places to understand that development. It won't come to you just from gazing at those institutions. So what I would be encouraging people to do is to think very broadly and to take on a whole range of different analytic frames in order to understand the complexity and the nuances of the development of systems, and therefore how we might think about changing them. I've long said that no single theory will hold tight as an explanatory framework for all things. And I have a range of folk that I would be introducing people to, like Rosa Molier at the bottom, Catherine Runswick Cole at the top, Foucault, Stephen Ball, Dan Goodley, and I've put Dave Gilmore, looking at critical race theory. I found that really useful in helping to think about disability and disability culture and exclusion. But I've also included a photo of Susan Gable and Missy Wharton, who, in their exasperation with the conservatism of inclusive education and its catch-all nation, catch-all kind of gathering, they're starting to develop notions of belonging. Because it's easier to test. People are either in or they're out. Partially in. I'm not sure that that really holds. And I did a really quick test of a test of the spread of inclusive education. I just on Saturday, I think it was, I'll tell you, Monday afternoon, I went onto Google and I got 15,700,000 hits. 14,800,000 hits in 50.50 seconds. Then I checked my figures again on 2 days later, and it climbed up to 15,700,000. And the thing about that is that if any of you really want to waste your life and do some kind of discourse analysis and thematic categorization of what all of those references are, you'll find a demonstration, I think, of what I'm talking about in terms of it being everything and nothing. It's become a description of all kinds of practices. And we'll get to some of those practices in the second bit. I guess you can take a sip from your glasses, shuffle your feet a little. But don't clap, they don't do that, do they? Okay. I'm going to introduce you to Rosa. This is just to give you a rest.
So if you look out here, you can actually see the Statue of Liberty. So like right over there. And these are like the other rich buildings where other people live.
My family is poor because we live in the projects. We don't live in, like, nowhere perfect. And my mom, she's been giving me a lot of money, like probably $2-3 to go to the store and things like that. I mean, my family is not like a perfect family, you know what I'm saying?
I can. I tried to be honest with you, and you say, oh, daddy, buy me this. I cannot because I don't have no money, Rosie. You understand what's going on?
I understand.
If I got the money, you think that I said no? You don't. No, if I got the money, I said I'd go with you.
I mean, I don't have what I want necessarily, but I do have like people that I love.
Okay. You see, she loves you.
My name is Rosa. It runs a Boza. I stick to the lyrics every day in Noza.
I admire Beyonce. I mean, if I ever meet her, I'm gonna cry. It's gonna be like so emotional for me. I mean, Mark. I mean, if what? Like, your favorite singer. Who's your favorite singer?
Billie Holiday.
You, if you meet him, right? You would like feel.
Okay, that, Stuart has just left the room, isn't it? Oh. Okay. it's an old photo. The couple of rows I really wanted to show you because of the Billie Holiday, but apart from that, what I want to start talking about is exclusion writ large in terms of privilege and disadvantage. Rosa is part of a documentary that was made by HBO, and I think it's called Class Divide, or Class Divided, and it's brilliant. It's looking at the gentrification of the Chelsea area of New York City and the multi-million dollar apartments that are right over the road from the project housing where Rosa lives. Rosa goes to a local school, but over the road is a school, The Avenue, a world school, which is fabulous school by the look of it. But to go there is $40,000 to $50,000 a year. So the local kids don't go except on scholarship, and there's one scholarship. It's a fascinating documentary about privilege and its absence. And I didn't have to go to America to do that, did I? You know those stories, and you know where they are, and some you don't know about. When I went to work at the Institute of Education, I was approached by Peter Hamilton, Michael Rice, Sally Power, to write a book for their series, Foundations and Futures of Education. And I wrote what I think now was a pretty pedestrian kind of proposal for the book. This is where inclusive education came from. I'm talking where it come from. And this is what's happened, what's transpired, and this is the future. It was that kind of proposal. When I sat down to write the book, I thought, well, that kind of book in various manifestations exists. They certainly don't need another one, and they certainly don't need it from me. So I had in my head this notion of the irregular school, because I wanted to say it's not about special and regular. I think trying to resolve whether it should be regular or whether it should be special is a backward glance, and we ought to be looking forward. I think history has challenged, and certainly liquid times, to quote Zygmunt Bauman, has certainly challenged the operation of schools in various and profound ways. So it's not a task of simply amalgamating regular and special and calling this inclusive. That's not what it is. I think it's about the development of new ways about thinking about education and coming up with something quite different, which really needs some creative professional imagination. I think questions for organising education for new times ought to pursue a different line of inquiry. What will our children and young people need to know, value, think and be able to do in order to live as good global citizens in democratic societies? What will our children and young people need to know, value, think and be able to do in order to fix the mess that we've made for them? What programs of learning are required? What do learning environments look like that will achieve this task? And there are a number of subsidiary questions. I'll give you one. How do we model in education the type of community our children deserve to live in? So those were the kinds of questions that I was grappling with. And I was thinking about the paradox that if you go and look at almost every school prospectus, you know, and I'm not being hypercritical, pointing the finger at schools and saying they're bad or anything. They do what they're instructed and what the pressure of the times tells them. And you'll see that in almost every prospectus, it's about educating children to be good global citizens in a democratic community. And that's great. But once you start to cut through that and say, well, what does that mean in terms of the curriculum? What does it mean in terms of teaching? What does it mean in the way of assessment? What does it mean in the organisation and the culture of the school? You start to see the gaps appear. So I'm amused by good global citizen, because oftentimes I think that it's about educating our children to know that they can use the world as their labour exchange, to get cheap products and develop a holiday itinerary from. So, I also think that democracy at the moment is causing considerable olfactory displeasure. One of the challenges I set myself in this lecture was not to mention Donald Trump. How could I not? Democracy has given us golden dawn in Greece, Donald Trump, One Nation. All are apparent degradations of the democratic spirit. Whether it was Voltaire writing in the 18th century or Beatrice Evelyn Hall writing about Voltaire in the 20th century, the principle of freedom of speech is a precondition of democracy that's worth fighting, perhaps dying for. When principles are compromised, we need to battle harder for their reinstatement. So, my education in democracy is where I just fiddled with my slides too much during the day. Starts with Alain Touraine, the French social theorist, who wrote a lovely book called Can We Live Together? And one of the passages in the book, he says you can read or evaluate or get a sense of the spirit of a society by looking at its education system or its legal system, its juridical system. And if you think about the judicial system in Australia, you can say, well, hey, we've got lots of equal opportunity, anti-discrimination legislation. But then if you cut deeper through it, think about the Disability Discrimination Act of 1992. There are exemptions, of course, the Department of Immigration. And people may be familiar with the case in Monash of the academic from Pakistan who 7 years hence could live in Australia with his wife and all of his children but one. So the choice of the family was, do they send that disabled child back to relatives in Pakistan, or do they go back to a situation that was particularly difficult for them? Touraine also says that if you want to be able to learn how to live together, well then it's the education system that will do that. A democratic education and an education in democracy is the way forward. I could talk more about Basil Bernstein and his 1996 book, where he talks about preconditions for democratic rights and responsibilities. And I'll just say in passing that he pays special mention, or gives special mention, to inclusion. And he complicates it. And this is the thing about talking about these concepts. They are more complex than they are than you would think at face value. He says inclusion is not absorption, but it may also be the right that people can exercise autonomy and separate themselves. And that, in my area of work, creates some real challenges and dilemmas. Think about it. The other person that I put in here is Mike Rose, who wrote this lovely book, Possible Lives. And it's just a chronicle of his travels around America, visiting schools, to try and build vignettes that gave a more accurate reading of American public education. Because he said that the press on public education in America, and it wouldn't happen here, was so diminishing and derisive that America was at risk of losing its boldest democratic experiment, public education, and that America is losing its civic imagination. He's right.
Yes.
Okay, so we go back. So, swirling around in my head to try and understand exclusion of these ideas about democracy and so on, I thought I'd hang on to that. Even though they're pretty smelly at the moment, they're still worth fighting harder for. And I inevitably read Dan Levitin's book, The World in Six Songs, and Dan Levitin was trying to explain why music was so much a part of our lives. And he borrowed from David Huron, the musicologist, who said, it's so because of its antiquity, or ubiquity and antiquity. It's everywhere, and it's been everywhere for a long time. And thus it becomes the wallpaper of our lives. And I thought, in the best of academic spirit. Gee, I'll have that. That really does explain exclusion for me. It's everywhere, and it's been everywhere, and you don't notice it all the time. It happens around you. And had we worked enough of time, maybe it'll come up in questions. I tell you some stories of the mundane moments of exclusion. So, from there, I thought, okay, I really have to write a social geography of exclusion, which means trying to characterize privilege and disadvantage. And then I went to Jeffrey Sachs and his work on the end of poverty. There's an extract that I want to read to you, with your permission. I won't look up in case I don't get it. Every morning, our newspapers could report more than 20,000 people perished yesterday of extreme poverty. The stories would put the stark numbers in context, up to 8,000 kids dead of malaria, 5,000 mothers and fathers dead of TB, 7,500 young adults dead of AIDS, and thousands more dead of diarrhea, respiratory infection, and other killer diseases that prey on bodies weakened by chronic hunger. The poor died in hospital wards that lack drugs, in villages that lack anti-malarial bed nets, in houses that lack safe drinking water. They die namelessly without public comment. Sadly, such stories rarely get written. And then there's another extract in the book, and he talks about this doctor in Malawi, which is, you know, a lovely segue given our discussion this morning with Kathleen. The doctor knows what could be done. He knows that each day, or each of these patients, could rise from their deathbed but for the want of a dollar a day. He knows the problem is simply that the world has seen fit to look away as hundreds of impoverished Malawians die this day as a result of their poverty. So I was really taken by, you know, one little passage in that. The world has seen fit to look away. And I was trying to get some notion of how do you look away? And we do it all the time. We do it all the time on the street. We avert our eyes from the beggar. We see things on television that are shocking and grotesque. We change the channel, perhaps, and so it goes. But we develop this kind of collective indifference, this shell, this protective shell around us. And I want to think about that in terms of education. I will tell a story to give you a kind of example. I was giving a talk in Greece, and just like here, a very excited audience. But they had headsets on, and they were getting translation. And a father from a disability advocacy group got up and he spoke. He spoke softly, he spoke slowly, and he said, "Every day, my son, he goes to school with his satchel on his back, and his satchel is full of hopes and dreams. Every night, he comes home, his satchel is empty. It has been emptied in the dirt." So I don't know what it sounded like in Greek, but in English, boy, that was really powerful. And later I was writing about it, but something else happened. The translators, the voice changed in my headphones, and I looked back, and one of the translators was leaving the translation booth in tears. And I thought, no, my story isn't the father, just the father. The story is really the translator. There's a room full of educators who weren't distressed. Perhaps they were. I may be being very unfair, but they weren't visibly shaken. We had built up our protection in all of this. Okay, so how do I get inside a bit more? And you will recognise and pay respect, sadly, to Zygmunt Bauman, who died just a matter of a couple of weeks ago. And in a book, Wasted Lives, he talks about liquid times and the organisation of our world is such that people increasingly, as Richard Sennett would say in the Culture of New Capitalism, are living under the spectre of uselessness. More and more people are becoming redundant. More and more people are surplus population, as he calls them. Surplus population. These are the wasted lives. And he says that they are the casual collateral casualties of liquid times. He says that in these times, as the discourse, the public discourse of inclusion, has become more shrill, the reality is that we suffer from mixophobia. We live in a state of ambient fear of the other. All societies create their own set of strangers, and they create their own strangers in their own inimitable way. And I was thinking then of Kathleen. I'm still concentrating on me, but I was thinking also of Kathleen. There was one passage that really got to me, and I am coming back to school here, folks. So I'm coming back to school. We're going to get there, and we're almost at the third bit. He says, the production of human waste has all the markings of an impersonal, purely technical issue. Principal actors in the drama are the terms of trade, market demands, competitive pressures, productivity or efficiency requirements, all covered up or explicitly denying any connection with the intentions, will, decisions and actions of real humans with names and addresses. And I found a wonderful, wonderful example of this. If you just copy that down for now. Let me tell you this story. When Maggie X died, the aged care home decided that her savings of 450 quid was insufficient to pay for the funeral and asked the council to pay it. The council refused, and the owner of the home appealed to the local ombudsman. In his comments to the latter, the council chief executive wrote that without wishing to appear insensitive, one could argue that from a commercial viewpoint, residents of its home are its income-producing raw material. Ergo, therefore, from a purely commercial view, deceased residents may then be regarded as being waste produced by their business. Since, he continued, the resident's body was controlled waste likely to cause pollution of the environment or harm to human health, the home had, under the definition of controlled waste, as defined by the Environmental Protection Act, a specific duty to dispose of the remains. Disposal, under the definitions of the Act, was a business cost. Maggie. So Maggie, at some time, somebody's mum, somebody's partner, lover, many people's friends, but all of that is evacuated. It disappears. Controlled waste. If we start to think about schooling, the liquid time scenario, and here I'm bridging into the third bit. The liquid time scenario, I think, holds. Many of you are scholars of education policy, and you have described the high-ordered culture, the formativity, you've described high-stakes testing and the impact of that on schools, and then schools having to profile in order to bring in their share of the market in terms of enrollment. You've written about the impact of that. So, if I was to describe the ethos or the ethical framework of education at the moment, I would say competitive individualism, and that students have been reduced to the bearers of results. So that, as Dave Gilmore and Debbie Dell said all that time ago in rationing education, schools, predictably, are getting fairly choosy about their markets. Not all schools. Some schools are getting very choosy about their clientele. And that's where I'm going to move to in the third part. Think about how do children become reduced? How did they become the surplus population? That's where we're going. The other segue into this was to just to say that something else in the contemporary education scene at the moment, and Peter and I talked about this not that long ago, there have been a number of reports recently right across education jurisdictions in Australia about education programs for students with disability, and they've not been pretty. I won't go into detail, you can follow them up. I will simply say that, for example, with the review of the disability standards for education, they found a list of seven themes of areas of difficulty and challenge. And I've put in yellow, this is my emphasis, contemporary education context. On the one hand, you're doing this about building disability standards, but other areas of policy making undermining any shift you might get there. I thought the Victorian Auditor General's report was particularly interesting, which was basically saying that the department has given this amount of money and they really don't know its effect, negative or positive, they just don't know. And we told them that 5 years ago, 3 years ago when the report, but it's still like that. Then there was a report from the Equal Opportunity and Human Rights Commission, and basically what they were saying is that for students with disability, it's a bit of a lottery in education. It's a bit of a lottery, and parents will report that. And I know that because at the moment I've been working with Deloitte Access Economics on a review of education of children with disabilities in Queensland, and parents will sit there and they will tell you about the lottery of school. And we all saw the sanctuary in the ACT. It had been the cage that abutted the classroom so the child could still participate by watching the class from within the cage. Now, I'm not condemning all schools and all teachers about that, but there's something in the psyche generally about what we can and can't do in this field. Now, how are we going? I'm going to move this pretty quickly. I called this section of the paper Unhinged. Now, I did that basically because that comes from Ulrich Beck, the Risk Society. He published a book called The Metamorphosis of the World this year, posthumously. And most people I've referenced today are dead. I'm going to read Scott Danforth after the lecture for the see how it's going. Beck says, the world is unhinged. As many people see it, this is true in both senses of the word. The world is out of joint and it has gone mad. We are wandering aimlessly and confused, arguing for this and against that. But a statement on which most people can agree beyond all antagonisms and across all continents is, I don't understand the world anymore. So, I thought, is it time for perspective? And here I start to write a little freely. Are you okay? Can we go? Yeah? And I'll read you what I wrote. No, I won't say anything. Perhaps it's a midlife or twilight grasp at or gasp of creativity. Ever so tentatively, you enroll in a drawing, a painting, or an art theory class at the local community college, community centre, or institution of higher education, HIRE. Inevitably, you encounter the laws of perspective. Some instructors will take you straight back to Chinese or Greek antiquity. Others will commence in the 15th century in Italy with Filippo Brunelleschi to introduce the vanishing point. 1, 2, 3, and 4-point perspective. Oh, that was Beck. And here we have a model of perspective. The laws found expression through increasingly sophisticated geometric modelling. Robert Hughes describes the grip of perspective in his book, The Shock of the New. He says, the 15th century artists, perspective was the philosopher's stone of art. One can hardly exaggerate the excitement they felt in the face of its ability to conjure up a measurable, precise illusion of the world. Artists over time have done what artists must do. They've challenged the laws of perspective and they've unstitched geometric straitjackets. Others have held firm, and it's very likely that your tutor will instruct you to create your parallel lines and find the vanishing point on your canvas or sketchbook. After all, you should learn the rules before you break them. Who's that from? Oh, come on. Branford Massage. You were here, I saw you. In superficial terms, for my understanding of art theory is entirely superficial, you'll observe that the representation of the road is broad at the bottom, or ground line, of the sketch, and it progressively narrows and recedes into the distance. The lampposts are drawn closer together as you move into that distance, and they become smaller, less clear or detailed, and much more faint. Where the lines of the road meet, you have found vanishing point, and this then sets the horizon line across the canvas. The eye has indeed been deceived, as Robert Hughes would have it. For the sake of metaphor, I'm going to accept the illusion, abide by the law of perspective, in order to observe this inversion in education. The organisation of the education canvas, where a line has been drawn between the so-called regular school and special school, forges its own rules of perspective, its own illusions that have trained our eye to see the world in a particular manner. According to Deb Udell, it's arguable that while special educational needs are often located on the fringes of education, it's in this location at the boundary that special education needs acts to define and ensure the continuity of education's normative centre. In Foucault, Power and Education, Stephen Ball elaborates the point concisely and poignantly. The school became, in many respects, an expression of humanity and a demarcation of the limits of humanity, who was and was not educable, of value, worth investing in. Pierre Bourdieu and Catherine Runswick-Cole gave her her inaugural lecture 2 weeks ago at Manchester Metropolitan, and she said, it's imperative that you mention at least one dead French philosopher. What is meant by institutions, us, or you? They are an organised fiduciary, organised trust, organised belief, a collective fiction recognised by belief and thereby becoming real. Clearly, to say of a reality that it is collective fiction is a manner of saying that it has a tremendous existence, but not as people believe it exists. Let me pursue this just for a moment more. There is nothing radical about suggesting that the regular neighbourhood school and their normal children represent the foreground of the education canvas. Accordingly, it's the main game. Accordingly, as we track through the regular school corridors to the back passages, the back passages, we will find students congregating, clutching their dossiers of diagnosis in what are euphemistically called inclusion rooms with their special needs or inclusion teacher, or more typically, an assistant. Keep tracking back towards the vanishing point of the education canvas, special school, and you will find that the detail applied to illustrate or describe these children paradoxically enlarges them through more detail according to the reductive representation of humanity to be found in the pages of DSM. I'll do some editing on. I know I've been going for just over an hour. The representation of special needs children or children with disabilities marks them out in greater distinctiveness, in bolder difficult to erase lines. But the representations are radically incomplete and they are horrible. Nevertheless, this purely technical rendition of the child is pervasive and it's powerful. It has antiquity and ubiquity on its side. Notwithstanding the transgression to the optic logic, by this enlargement of detail and heaviness of lines as we move to the nether regions of the education canvas, we have accepted the illusion. This is reality. And as we observed in our depiction of the metaphor, illusion is the point of art. So it's hard to make your eye do what I'm describing. You still see that thick line as the front. I was going to talk about Lowry, because I love his work, and how we accept the illusions that he creates in those little blobs of paint. But I won't. I'll go straight to thinking about DSM-5. I just want to give a very crude argument, and I hope it isn't too crude. DSM is a particularly powerful and pervasive document now. And if you look at Nicholas Rose's work on the politics of everyday life, read into that our notion of our somatic self, of our selves as a health, as a life, as a vitality project, is spread in various ways. And he takes a five-line inquiry to understanding that. And I won't go through that. DSM is the description of various conditions of mental illness and behavior disorder. It's a changing document where once homosexuality was a mental disorder, it's not in the pages now. Conditions come and they go, and I couldn't resist Loonig and his awful party, where the gentleman hosting the party is surrounded by the too hard, the too old, the too pathetic, the too ugly, the too strange, and I forgot what the last one, so it's chopped off by the engine. Trouble for me was I found myself in too many baskets at once. I just want to, as a way of moving towards a conclusion, to think about the work of Russell Barkley and the expansion of ADHD as a syndrome, as a disorder that we well know. My project is not to say that it doesn't exist. I'm not saying that at all. But I'm saying that there are some perverse effects of diagnosis, difference in diagnosis rates, in incidence, and so on, suggests to me that we need to examine this a little further. Russell Barkley is now particularly interested in developing work around sluggish cognitive tempo disorder, of which you are well now suffering. And I take all of the credit for that. But if you look at, say, for example, at data from the Australian Institute of Illness and Wellbeing, they'll say, and you'll see these figures in all kinds of places, I was going to read you a passage from that, I won't. But you'll see, you know, 1 in 4 children will have a mental illness in the life of their schooling. I am, again, not saying mental illness doesn't exist. My worry is that it becomes a proxy for problems in school. That's all that I'm saying there. And my question is, how do we safeguard against that? Especially now, when we know that the history of regular and special, I'm not saying it's a history of special education, it's a history of regular and special education together, have created such disproportionality in the representation of minorities in special education. So in America, African American, Latino children, in England, Caribbean, in New Zealand, in Maori, in Pacifica, in Australia, and Aboriginal children. There's under and over diagnosis. These are problems. So that's my question in all of this. You know, firstly, what has happened to our reference points that we apply to young people? And we're using more technical language, and it's reductive. And it gives, I think, less possibility for intervention beyond the therapeutic. And in doing that, we've given permission for a whole range of people to look away. And this is not our problem. This surplus population needs to be with people who know how to work with them. And so it goes. I was going to finish because this... No, not going to finish. I am finishing. Because with a recent work I've been doing in Ethiopia, because of Kathleen's talking about it this morning. This is the schools that I visited. Not uncommon for classrooms of 9 kids. This was a special school that I went to, and it's just a building with cardboard rooms within it, and you'll see the kids in the room. And there's the fence, special place for special kids. The thing, and this is where I will stop, the principal of the school was talking to this group of visitors that I was part of, and she said, our school started off as a school for deaf kids, and then we got kids with intellectual disabilities. She referred to it differently. But we have a problem. We have a problem at this school. The parents, when they come to drop off the children, it's impossible for them then to take the other children to another school. They can't do it. It's too far. They don't have cars, and so on. So they leave these normal children at our school, and our teachers have a problem. How are we going to educate normal children? And I've been waiting for a long, long time for somebody to ask me that question, because it's always the other way around. It's always these children with disabilities who are the additional children, no matter where they are in the enrollment queue, they're the additional kids in the classroom. And finally, the principal said to me, how are we going to educate these problematic normal kids? Thank you for your patience. You need another drink.
I'm reminded of one of my favourite authors, an author called John Berger, an art critic, who left England because he hated it so much in the 70s to live in France. And I've often watched him in an interview, and it's like watching somebody think and talk at the same time. And I think we just witnessed this. It's very much watching Roger actually think through these big questions and suppose many questions. So thank you very much, Roger. We'll open up to a few questions, and if you don't mind, I'll take the first one. It seems to be very much that you're talking about inclusion and exclusion, and sometimes to know one, you have to know the other. But what about that role that's in between inclusive exclusion or exclusive inclusion? Could you reflect on that, please?
Yeah, I can. Gary Hornby, British English, north of England, near where Lowry came from, academic who was at Canterbury University in Christchurch, wrote a book called Inclusive Special Education, or Special Inclusive Education. I never remember anymore which order they come in. And while I was at the Institute, we ran a master's program in inclusive education and special educational needs. The two appear, you know, together all the time. You walk around schools and you will inevitably find the room within the school, typically towards the back of the school, maybe outside the school, near the fence, it's in the fence, that is part of this kind of inclusion program. But it's just children with disabilities, or who are described as having disabilities. And, you know, what I'm looking at, yeah, that's where that perspective thing just goes bananas. And I think, you know, is this still part of my kind of problem of getting cataracts fixed? Has it ruined me forever? It's good to see colour. Is it worth it? I have no perspective anymore because I'm constantly challenged when people describe one thing with the terminology of a model.
Thank you. I'll just pass the microphone around. So
that's all right, I have a big voice, Stephen.
There's people listening abroad as well.
Oh,
we're okay. Live streaming.
You're going to Malta.
Oh, okay, cool.
That's nice.
thanks, Roger. So, this is an educational institution of higher education, and when we think about inclusion in this institution, then obviously, you know, the gaze turns back on ourselves. With a couple of colleagues, Garth Stoll and Cassie Blerzer, we've been having a look at how universities signal to the world the kind of person that a university is for.
Yeah.
And we've undertaken a systematic analysis of universities' promotional materials, and I wonder if you can guess what one of the findings is. It's actually very hard to find in universities' representations of it, you know, its community to those who may be interested in joining the community. It's very hard to find images of people with what I might call evident disabilities, because obviously not all disabilities are so visible. And I just wonder if you would like to just talk a little bit about the implications of what you've been saying for, you know, our educational institution of higher education.
Yeah, thank you. That really is a great and challenging question. Are there any others? Sorry, I am thinking and struggling to talk. Why I'm faltering here is I'm continually thinking about the different points of tension in all this. I can give you examples, say, for example, from University of Alberta, University of Calgary, where they have developed a certification for programs for people with intellectual disabilities. And their enrollments have steadily increased. Thanks to the work of people like Bruce Yudinsky in Edmonton and Inclusion Alberta, they're getting people through university, through certification and into work. And then, you know, magnificent and very different programs where some of it is auditing classes, and some of it is where they're doing assessment and building their learning stories. And that's how they describe the assessment to be able to get certification with the university emblem. And that's successful. Trish O'Brien at University of Sydney is doing likewise successfully through the ages of the Faculty of Medicine. They've been able to get their Centre for Disability Studies testimony, and they've not got the University of Sydney emblem on that yet. But that's coming. So there are, and we're putting together a book at the moment where we're talking about young people's experience with disabilities, experiences in university, so it's growing. The other part of the picture too is in other areas of disability where you start getting to learning difficulty rather than learning disability, where the numbers and the costs ramp up really quickly, and it's difficult for universities to deal with that in a fiscal sense. So that, you know, that becomes a real challenge there. But all of this is a challenge that makes education better, as you're inferring, Sue, from your question. Now, there are no simple solutions to this, but progressively, just as we did, you know, there was a time, I was going to say I can remember, but I can't, I wasn't there, where the Victorian College of the Art had its special program for the women of Munchie, what an unprotected statue will do to you. And then the women's life drawing classes, Kim Ballard has wonderful photos of these women sitting around a cow, and you can tell the stories of different faculties that have increasingly thought, the problem isn't women, the problem is patriarchy. How is patriarchy expressed? Pedagogy, curriculum, assessment, organisation of resources, the structure of the workforce, and systematically we've done something about that. And I reckon it's the same challenge. The challenge isn't to say, you know, the challenge for women wasn't to say, are they mildly, moderately, or profoundly female? And can we get an intervention to help them fit into masculine institutions? No, we said patriarchy is a problem. That's got to change. And I think the same with ableism. Thank you. Sorry, I was stood on my soapbox here.
We'll take one more question. Professor Rigney.
I didn't realise I was last. Thank you very much, Professor Slee. Very eloquent, very timely. I just appreciate the intellectual rigour around what I'm passionate about, and that is inclusion, its geography and its architecture.
Yeah.
I read Robin Kelly's book, who defends black African American single mums. And the book is called Your Mama's Dysfunction. And and Robin goes on to suggest that the reason why exclusion happens is based on your mama's dysfunction. And that it's no fault of the government for your exclusion. It's your mama's dysfunction.
Yeah.
And so it's a really interesting take on inclusion. And in the end, Robin's talking about, in which you talk about the democracy, which I found fascinating. And if you read Robin's book, Your Mom's Dysfunction, at the end it sort of gets to the point that says that exclusion is based upon a government that's out of touch. And in Australia, we know that Australia is becoming...
Are you saying the American government is out of touch?
So in Australia particularly, it's become extremely unequal. You know, 10% of Australian families own half of the national wealth. So Robert's right. There's an oligarchic democracy. A democracy of the people that is not by the people. So if the majority are poor and an oligarchy democracy is governed for those who are privileged, How do you get included? If I can challenge some of your concepts today,
yeah.
And that is that isn't inclusion the problem at the moment? It's being framed as the problem, and that we should build fixed fortifications to exclude, and that will bring us closure. That will bring us salvation. So I'm asking you, doesn't inclusive education require inclusive leadership, not an oligarchy democracy?
Yes. and I'll say a couple of other things. Absolutely right, and that is a bit, that is the stuff of what I was saying, is that, yeah, democracy, inclusion, maybe jazz, that's a stretch, or on the nose, but that's not the reality of the problem. It's exclusion that is the difficulty. Inclusion can unwittingly or wittingly become, can be commissioned into the project of exclusion. And I can see that in many examples. Or, you know, exclusion is a problem. We do that exclusion in all sorts of ways. As you've said, the war, eugenics, does a responsible person not submit to amniocentesis? We have made decisions about the population and who we want in this world. And I'm not putting myself above all of this as the moral authority. All of this is challenging and tough. But you're absolutely right that therefore you redouble your efforts to try and find authenticity in inclusion. And my bet is that you're not going to find it as much from the state as you were describing, Irabina, and Kathleen was describing, and Muhammad was describing. You will find it in those kind of organic manifestations of the local people, some teachers in the school deciding that the world can be otherwise. Some parents, community members, elders, women. But yeah, I do share your view.
Thank you very much. I think we'll draw the proceedings to the end. Thank you so much for sharing your world, Roger.
Thank you.